I want to, with everyone's permission, give you a workout. I think we should work out our legs a little bit and let's kneel again if that's okay. Father, I pray that as we come to you now, that you will fill us with your Spirit. Father, I pray that you will guide my mind, guide my lips, and touch my lips with a coal from off your altar. Father, I pray also that you will anoint the eyes and the ears of those watching and listening, that your words and your thoughts may be conveyed accurately and adequately. Father, I pray that I will not only speak your words, but that I will present your body language and your tone of voice even, that I may accurately present your thoughts to the people. Father, I pray a special blessing upon not only this presentation, but upon this camp meeting. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. My notes are too far for me to see, so I'm going to have to play this from the Bible, which is what we should do anyways, right?
Amen.
Right, straight from the Bible. Now, I apologize. I'm going to try to keep up, because normally the computer's in front of me, and I'm doing it that way. So I'll try to keep up with the PowerPoints.
Just a quick note, Andy. If there's anyone who can't see the screen well or doesn't hear Andy well, the best seats are still up front, just so you know.
Does not Ellen White say something about
Yes, she does. The
empty seats being taken by the wrong angels?
Yes.
So the A students are always up front, and there is still time to move to the front.
The front row is going to heaven first.
The front row is the first to enter heaven, yes, it should be at least. You know, there's coming a time we're talking about the final atonement. There's coming a time where we're going to have to stand before juries and judges and magistrates, and we're going to have to answer for what we believe, right?
Yes.
There are two main things that I believe we're going to really have to answer for. Number one is the biblical Father and Son, right? We're really going to have to show that from the Bible and the Bible alone. And the other thing that really sets us apart is our understanding of Daniel chapter 8 and verse 14. And we need to be able to show these things clearly and adequately from the Bible and the Bible alone. Why am I saying the Bible and the Bible alone? Am I trying to put down the writings of Ellen White? Not in any way, shape, or form. You notice on the day of Pentecost, when Peter started preaching, he preached a sermon that was so powerful that most of the congregation looked at one another and said, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Now, you know the preacher's done a good job when the people in the congregation say, "What shall we do?" He's gotten their attention. So Peter preached a very powerful sermon that day. And if you look at that sermon, you'll note that Peter did not use Jesus to prove Jesus. Why did he not do that? Because the Jews did not recognize Jesus as a source of authority. Does that mean that Jesus was not inspired? Of course not. But what Peter did was he went back to that which he knew everyone would agree to as a source of inspired authority. We recognize that Ellen White is a source of inspiration. We recognize that Ellen White is a source of inspiration, but when we're standing before a judge and jury, are they going to recognize that as a source of inspiration? Probably not. So then we need to fall back to proving everything from the Bible.
Amen.
And we should be able to prove it from the Bible anyways.
Amen. That's right.
I believe that there is going to, this is a little side note, I believe that there's going to come a day when there's going to be a hard shaking on the writings of Ellen White. I believe the devil is going to attack them.
You don't think it's over here?
It is. It's coming. It started. But it's going to get a lot worse, and there's going to be a lot of people who have their theology based only on Ellen White. And it might be correct theology, but if they can't show it from the Bible, a lot of these people are going to fall from truth.
Amen.
So we need to be able to show it from the Bible. So with that being said, how many can give a Bible study right now showing the timeline of Daniel 8:14. Amen. All right. So this is going to be a little bit of a review for you. Now, for those who can't, what I'm trying to do is, it's not my goal. I'm not going to go into the daily. Okay? I'm going to try to keep this simple and very basic, and the main focal point is going to be outlining the timelines and showing the timeline. That is where we need to start. So I want to start with a quick review. And obviously, you know, this is actually a three-part series, and I'm giving the final part to this. But part number one is going through Daniel chapter 2, and then looking at Daniel chapter 7 and the little horn power. And I go through and I showed the 12 biblical points of the little horn power right straight from the Bible. And as I'm giving that, there can be non-Adventists in the congregation, and generally by the time I get to point number 3 or 4, I start seeing light bulbs go off. Amen. You know, as people are saying, Vatican? Because it becomes very clear. And it's right straight from the Bible, just 12 points. And I think we should all be able to show those points right straight from the Bible so that other Christians can go, well, that's got to be the Vatican. There's no other answer.
That's
right. So Daniel 2 and Daniel 7 are important to understand, those specific points. And then also, the second part, I go into greater depth on Daniel 7:25, the time, times, and dividing of time, because that's important to understand in understanding Daniel 8:14. We need to know the 1798, and we're going to show that here in just a few minutes. That 1798 date is going to help us solidify the final date of Daniel 8:14. And we need to know the date, the day for year. And it's a good idea for us to understand why the day year applies and show why it the literal time cannot work. So in Daniel chapter 2, we've got the head of gold, basically the metal man, right? I think we all should have a pretty basic understanding of Daniel chapter 2. But the main focal point of Daniel chapter 2 is the rise and fall of these nations, all of these nations. Daniel chapter 2 is kind of a broad outline. And we need to understand Daniel 2 as that broad outline. Now, Daniel chapter 7 repeats some of that outline with the lion, the bear, and the four-headed leopard. But if you look at Daniel chapter 7, you'll notice the bulk of Daniel chapter 7 is dealing with what?
Little horn.
The little horn, right?
Mm-hmm.
You find very little bit said on the lion, the bear, and the four-headed leopard, but you find the bulk of Daniel chapter 7 is focusing in on that little horn. Why? Because that is now new information to Daniel. He already understood, basically, the lion, the bear, and the four-headed leopard. So he doesn't need a bunch more information on that. What he needs now is further information on the little horn power. So that's why the angel goes greater in detail on the little horn powers, because this is new information. So the main focal point of Daniel chapter 7 is that little horn. And we get into Daniel chapter 8, and the main focal point of Daniel 8 kind of gets missed. Why? Does anybody know what happens? Daniel passes out, right? He faints. So the full answer, the full focal point of Daniel chapter 8 doesn't really happen. So let's go ahead, and I want to talk about an important sequence of events. Now remember, I'm not going into great detail. What I want everyone to come to conclusion is this sequence of events, because the sequence of events is very important. Daniel chapter 7, verse 21. If you want to open up your Bibles with me. Daniel chapter 7 and verse 21. I'll wait till I hear the pages stop. I like to hear the pages of the Bible rustling. Daniel chapter 7 and verse 21 says, "And I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them." What time period is this referring to? Something ages.
Dark.
The Dark Ages, right? So this is a clear reference to the Dark Ages. Remember that. We're going to look at the sequence of events. So first comes the Dark Ages. Verse 22, "Until the Ancient of Days came, and what was given to the saints?"
Judgment.
Judgment. So what is spoken of next after the Dark Ages?
Judgment
is spoken of. The next part of verse 22 says, "And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom." What is this a reference to? Second coming, right? The advent of Christ. Something to do with the advent of Christ. So what we've got in that sequence of events is the little horn power and the Dark Ages. And then what happens after that is a judgment. And you could call it a post-Dark Ages judgment, or you could call it a pre-Advent judgment. Why? Because it comes just before the Advent. Well, the reason I bring that up is because a lot of people hear of it as the pre-Advent judgment.
Yeah, right.
And so I'm putting it in the context of a judgment that comes just before the Advent. So you've got the Dark Ages, then you've got a judgment, and then you've got the advent of Christ, or something dealing with the advent of Christ. Can you see that sequence of events there? Okay, so let's go to verse 25, 26, and 27. "And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time." So now this is clearly talking about the Dark Ages again, roughly, right? "Shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and they shall be given into his hand for a time, times, and dividing of time." Time is 1 year, times is 2 years, and dividing of time is half a year. 2 + 1 + 1/2 is 3.5, right? So this started, we all know, in 538. If we add 3.5 literal years to that, that brings us to 541.5. What happened to the Antichrist power in 541.5?
Nothing.
Exactly. So we know that that doesn't work in applying literal. We know we have to apply day for a year. And that brings us, if we do the day for a year, that brings us to 1798. Did something happen to the little horn power in 1798?
Yes.
Absolutely. General Berthier, right? Okay, so what we saw there clearly then is not just the Dark Ages, but a specific time frame has been given now. 1798. Remember that. What happens next in verse 26? "But the judgment shall sit." The what?
Judgment.
Judgment. Judgment is now spoken of, and it comes after what?
1798.
That's important to remember when we're looking at the timeline, so that we know we get the timeline right. The timeline must fall after 1798. So this is helping us to narrow this down. And then in verse 27, "And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heavens shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him." What's this a reference to? Something to deal with the advent of Christ, right? Or post-advent.
Yeah.
Post-second coming.
When the kingdom is delivered to its people.
When the kingdom is delivered, yes. So it's after the second coming. So now in Daniel 7, 25 to 27, we see another important sequence of events. And again, I'm not trying to get into great detail on these sequences. What I'm trying to do is drive into the mind a sequence of events. I want to try to bring forth these sequences so that they can be shown and remembered. It's easier to remember this timeline, at least for me, when I remember the sequence of events. So the little horn and its persecuting power ending in 1798, and then you have a judgment, and then you have something dealing with the advent of Christ, the second coming. Now in Daniel chapter 8, verses 9 to 13, I'm not going to go through them. But in Daniel chapter 8, verses 9 to 13, it's talking about what power? The little horn power again, right? What happens in verse 14? What's verse 14?
It's an answer to a question.
Under 2,300 days, then shall this sanctuary be cleansed, right? Mm-hmm. So, all of a sudden, the sequence of events seems to change, or does it? No, it doesn't. So you've got the little horn power, but now you've got the cleansing of the sanctuary. Is that the same as a judgment?
No.
Friends, we need to... What's that?
The Day of Atonement.
The Day of Atonement. We need to understand the Old Testament, the typical sanctuary service. We need to understand these things. We need to be feast keepers.
Yeah.
Very silent. We are a part of... We're a part of the body of Christ, are we not?
Amen.
Does not the body follow the head?
Yes.
And the head is who?
Christ.
Jesus. And he's the high priest, right?
Amen.
Is he officiating in something right now?
Yes.
The Day of Atonement. Amen. So the body is going to be participating in the Day of Atonement. Now the body's not going to move ahead of the head and go into another feast. It can't, and it won't.
Amen.
And if it does, then friends, you're separating from the body because the body is following the head.
Amen.
But we need to understand these feasts. We need to understand them. We can't think, oh, there's this movement going on over there and we need to shun it so far that we don't even look at them. We need to understand these because they lay out a prophecy. They are an acted out prophecy.
Amen.
And if we don't understand this prophecy, we're going to miss things. So we need to understand. And when we look at the typical feast system, is there a feast that deals with cleansing the sanctuary and judgment at the same time?
Amen.
The Day of Atonement. It deals with both those things at the same time. So, after the little horn and its persecuting power, we then see the Day of Atonement, which is the judgment spoken of in Daniel 7, and it's the cleansing of the sanctuary spoken of in Daniel 8. They're both the exact same events, just under a different description. One is talking about judgment, and the other is talking about cleansing of the sanctuary. So we know that the cleansing of the sanctuary must come after the little horn power. Does that make sense? You see that important sequence of events? Okay. So with that important sequence of events, let's look at Mara versus Kazon. Mara versus Kazon. This is important to understand. You know, when Peter, after Jesus had been crucified and resurrected, Peter's in the boat and he looks out and he sees someone standing on the shore. You remember that story? Peter jumps out of the boat and he swims over to him, and Jesus comes to him and he says to Peter, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter says, "Yea, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus says, "Feed my lambs." And then Jesus asks him again, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter says, "Yea, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus says, "Feed my sheep." Well, why is he saying that? And then he asks him a third time. Jesus says, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter all of a sudden gets upset. Why does Peter get upset? Peter says, "Yea, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." So something is going on that we're not catching in the English. If we look at that, Jesus asks Peter, "Peter, do you agape me? Do you have an unconditional love for me?" And Peter's response, Peter says, "Yea, Lord, you know that I phileo you." Peter is just admitting that he doesn't have that complete love for Christ that he should. He says, "Lord, you know that I only love you like a brother, that I don't love you as I should. I think you should know that. I just denied you three times." And so Jesus gives him the cure. "Feed my lambs." Spread the gospel. That's the cure. You know, friends, if you don't have a true and complete love for Christ, spread the gospel. You'll get it quick. You'll get a love for Christ quick by spreading that gospel.
Amen.
And so Jesus asks him the second time, Peter, do you agape me? And Jesus said, or Peter says, yea, Lord, you know that I phileo you. And Jesus gives Peter the cure, feed my sheep. And the third time Jesus asks Peter, he says, Peter, do you phileo me? In other words, Jesus is asking Peter, Peter, I recognize that you don't have an agape love for me, but do you love me like a brother? Do you really love me like a brother? And this is why Peter gets upset, is because Peter knows that he loves Jesus like a brother at least. And Peter gets upset and he says, yea, Lord, you know everything. You know that I have a brotherly love for you. So can you see how seeing the Greek there really helps to understand what's going on? The same thing is going on in Daniel chapter 8. There's one word in the English, it's vision. But in the Hebrew, it comes from two different words. And so it has two different meanings that we're missing if we're not seeing that Hebrew word. If you look in Daniel chapter 8 and verse 26, and the vision of the evening and the morning, which was told is true, wherefore shut thou up the vision, for it shall be for many days. We see the English, vision, vision. But if we look in the Hebrew, we see two different words in that one verse. And the mara of the evening and morning, which was told is true, wherefore shut thou up the kazon, for it shall be for many days. So what do they mean? What does mara mean? What does kazon mean? Well, remember, in verse 26, it says, and the mara of the evening and morning. Now, if you go back to Daniel 8:14, and he said unto me, unto 2,300, what's the next word?
Days.
In the King James.
Evenings and mornings.
But it's literally evenings and mornings. Exactly. So when you look at Daniel 8:26, and the vision, or the mara of the evening and morning, what's that referring to? Verse 14, right? It's pointing you back to verse 14. So the evening and morning, the mara, is intimately connected to the time of the vision. Does that make sense? The kazon is the vision in totality, the vision at large, but the mara is more specifically connected to the time period. And the reason that is important, let's go to verse 15. And it came to pass when I, Daniel, had seen the vision and sought for the meaning. Then behold, there stood before me as the appearance of a man, and I heard a man's voice between the banks of the Ulai, which called and said, Gabriel, make this man to understand the mara. Make him to understand the what?
Mara.
The mara. What did Daniel not understand? The mara, right? Daniel did not understand the time prophecy. Daniel already understood the rest of the vision. He already understood what these beasts were because this had already been given to him twice now. So he understood the beasts. What he did not understand was the time aspect related to the beasts. And if you go to verse 27, it says, and I, Daniel, fainted and was sick certain days. Afterward, I rose up and did the king's business, and I was astonished at the vision, and the Hebrew there is mara. But did not understand it. What did Daniel not understand? The mara, the time period that was given. He did not understand verse 14. So remember that. What did Daniel not understand? The 2300 days. Did Daniel understand the beasts?
Yes.
Evidently, he understood the beasts. He didn't say, I didn't understand the kazon, the vision in totality. He specifically said, the one thing he did not understand was the mara, the vision of the 2300 days. That is very important to understand. And I apologize, I didn't keep up with my slides. So, let's go now to Daniel chapter 9. Because all of a sudden, something happens You noticed the sequence of events that I was showing you in Daniel chapter 7. You had the little horn power, and then you had the judgment, and then you had something dealing with the second coming of Christ. And then in Daniel chapter 8, you get the little horn power, and then you get the sanctuary is cleansed, but you really don't get an explanation for that. And it's because Daniel faints. So no explanation is given. And Daniel is left without an understanding. It's important to remember. He is left without an understanding of the time period. So when we go to Daniel chapter 9, what we see is Daniel 9, 1 to 20 is Daniel's prayer. And it's important to notice in that prayer, Daniel does not ask God for an understanding of anything. Nothing. Because if he did, then the logical response of the vision given to him would have been an answer to what he asked for, an understanding. But he didn't ask for any understanding. So therefore, when we go into the explanation, what must this angel be explaining? Something that Daniel didn't understand, right? The only thing that we know of that Daniel didn't understand to this point is the Mara, the 2300 days, evenings and mornings, as it's literally translated. So in Daniel 9, 21 to 23, I'm going to go ahead and read that. Daniel chapter 9, verses 21 to 23. Daniel says, "Yea, while I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in a vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding." Skill and understanding in what? The Mara. Yeah, I'm wanting repetition. Repetition deepens the impression. So I realize I'm being repetitious, but I'm doing it intentionally because it deepens the impression. The more we say it, the more we'll remember it. Does that make sense? Okay. So the only thing that Daniel is left without an understanding in is the time period. He didn't ask for any understanding in his prayer. So the logical conclusion then must be that the angel is giving him an understanding in that which he lacked understanding, the time period. Verse 23, "And at the beginning of thy supplication, the commandment came forth, and I came to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved, therefore understand the matter and consider the vision." The chazon. This is chazon. So he is referring Daniel back to a vision. Did Daniel have a vision between Daniel 8 and Daniel 9:23?
No.
No. There has been no vision. So the chazon must refer back again to Daniel 8 and that vision. So the angel is clearly telling him, I am here to give you an understanding of that which you did not understand. And the reason he didn't understand is because he fainted. So at this point, I normally want a whiteboard here because I want to draw it out for you. Because that's kind of the point, yes.
Was it the Mara or the Kazon? I thought it was the Mara.
It was the Mara that Daniel did not understand. The Mara is the 2300 days, yes. But the angel is referring back to the vision in totality. He's telling Daniel, I'm come to give you an understanding of that vision that you had. The complete vision, yes. So it's a complete vision in the sense of general reference back to the last vision that he had. And that was Daniel chapter 8 and that vision. But he goes into detail. If you read chapter 9, you see that he's not giving information on the little horn or the goat or the ram. He's giving information on the time period. So the explanation is not about the goat and the ram and the little horn. The explanation is clearly about time. So it must refer back to the Mara aspect of the chazon, the time aspect of the vision. So at this point, I hope you're visual. I hope you can visualize this with me because I can't write it out and draw it out. But what I want to do is I want to make this simple because, you know, for a long time I'd read this and I said, I just don't understand. This is so confusing, these time periods. How do I understand this? And I'd read a book, and I'd get done with the book, and okay, I got it. And 5 days later, huh? What was that again? How do I couldn't duplicate it. So this is how it works for me. This is what was easiest for me. Verse 24. I'm going to start. It says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city. I'm going to stop there. I'm not going to continue reading that. 70 weeks are determined. That word determined, and I'm going to intentionally mispronounce this, shatok. What is the correct pronunciation?
What?
Shatok in Daniel?
Cut off?
The Hebrew? Okay. I believe it's, you know, what I hear normally is shatok. But I intentionally mispronounce it as shatok. Why? There's a knife that chefs like to use. Anybody think of a knife that sounds like that? Shatok? Shataki, right? There's a knife called the shataki knife. So I intentionally mispronounce this word shatok because it helps me to remember that a knife is used to cut something off. So here in Daniel chapter 9, verse 24, 70 weeks are shatokied off.
Right.
They are cut off. Cut off from what? Well, the angel doesn't clearly tell us, except by reference in verse 23 where he says he's come to give him understanding. Or verse 22 where he says he's come to give him understanding. So this time period that the angel is about to give, he clearly tells us has been cut off, but cut off from what? It must be cut off from the earlier time period that was given that Daniel did not understand. And there's a couple of reasons I like to present this, or the way I like to think about this, is the angel is giving now an anchor point for the time period. This is important to remember. This time period that he's giving is an anchor point. If we move this time period a little one way or the other, we're going to see that it destroys the anchor, which is the cross. So it's an anchor point to help us to remember this time period in broad. So verse 24, 70 weeks are cut off, shatakied off, like a knife, cut off from the original time period and upon thy people. So if we had a chart here, we could draw out a total 70-week time. Now, the way I remember it is you draw a line and you start from the left and work to the right, like you're reading, right? So you start from the left and you work to the right with these timelines. So you would draw out a time period and mark it 70 weeks. So the first thing that comes up is 70 weeks. Verse 25, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. So it says right there, it gives us an anchor point from the going forth of the commandments to restore and to build Jerusalem. Now what time period is that? Does anybody know right off the top of their head?
Time period.
The starting point.
457,
yes. Now, why don't we use one of the earlier ones? One of the earlier commandments?
Because there are two conditions.
Two conditions?
It says restore and to build. Restore is talking about restoring the kingdom, not just building. And the first commandments which were given specify that they could rebuild, but it says nothing about restoring Jerusalem as a nation. And that was
Bingo. One
of the power that was given by Artaxerxes to those that went back. It reestablished Jerusalem as a power and gave it a governor. So it was semi-independent. Though it was still a vassal, it was given an independence as a kingdom. And so that was it's the only commandment that can fulfill that.
Bingo. So that is why when people ask, well, why don't you use one of the earlier ones? Because the earlier ones only gave the authority to build. They did not give Jerusalem its own ruling power. It could not rule itself. So, as he said, now with 457, with the decree that was given at this point, it now has the ability to rule itself.
Amen.
And to be an independent kingdom, if you will. Autonomous, yes.
It's the one recorded in Ezra 7, also verbatim from Artaxerxes himself.
Yeah. It is, and that is, Ezra chapter 7 is not recorded in Hebrew. It is recorded in its original language. And when you read that, you see something different. You know, it's not recorded in Hebrew because it's literally a copy of that which was given by Artaxerxes. And so that's also another clue. So verse 25, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem, not just build Jerusalem, but restore and build Jerusalem. So that comes out to 457 BC. And, you know, I'm not very good with numbers. You might want to just have to write that in your Bible, 457, if you're not good with numbers like I'm not. I have to write that one down because I can't always remember that. And so I pray that when I'm standing before the court, if I don't have this Bible, I'm going to have to request it. And then it says, go forth, I'll just start over. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince. Now, who is this?
Jesus.
It has to be Christ. This isn't the Antichrist. A lot of people like to say this is the Antichrist, but it says Messiah. That literally is the Anointed One. Is the Antichrist the Anointed One?
No.
No, now he might think he is. He might claim he is.
Place.
Yeah, but he's not the Anointed One. He's trying to take his place, but he's not the Anointed One. So this can only refer to Christ. And it says, until this point shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Now, how many is a score?
20.
So 60 is 60. Plus 2, 62. Why didn't he just say 69? 62 plus 7 is 9, right? 69?
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't he just say 69 or 69? Why did he break that 7 out?
An occurrence.
This, yes. Now, this is for me, this is kind of the confusing part. I had to dig to figure out, what is that seven weeks? You know, I could read different authors, but how did I find that out? You know, how did I dig that and search it out? The best that I can say is it's dealing with the building and the building of Jerusalem and the time period with which they were given. The Bible doesn't clearly expound upon that right here. That's something you've got to dig into history. Yes?
The Jews did mention that Jesus said this building was 46 years in building.
Yes. That's a good point. Yes.
Yeah.
A very good point.
So it was mentioned in the Bible.
Yes. You're right. What I was pointing out is it's not clearly mentioned right here in Daniel 9. So you do have to dig through other parts of the Bible to figure it out and look back in history to see it. But the simple answer is it was a time period given for the Jews to be able to build. And so
it went through three phases.
Three phases,
yeah.
Yes. So you've got 7 weeks, which is shown. That doesn't show up. Okay. You've got the 7 weeks here as cut out. You need to remember that. So you've drawn the 70 weeks, and now you're going to start from the left side again with this new time prophecy given, and you're going to draw out 7 weeks and then the 62 weeks, which is a total of 69, right? 69 minus 70 is what? One. So there's 1 week so far that's not mentioned. And we'll remember that that's got to be here.
Mm-hmm.
So you start from the left and work to the right. The first one is the 70-week time period. You draw that out. And then when you come to the next verse, you get another time prophecy, and you draw it from the left to right again. So you start with the 7 weeks, and then the 62 weeks. So you're working left to right, left to right. Verse 26. And it says, after 62 weeks. After 62, what's 62 weeks? You know, it specifically says after the 62 weeks. The King James doesn't render the word the in there, but it's there. It's after the 62 weeks. What 62 weeks has been mentioned? The 62 weeks, right? So it must be talking about some time period after the 62-week time period. Does that make sense? So it's not talking about a whole new time period. It's not giving a whole new layout. It's simply explaining that which has been already been given after the 62 weeks. So we're going to keep reading that. After the 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Now, it's not saying at that time period, as soon as the 62 weeks are done, he shall be cut off. It's referring to the time period of the 1 week after the 62. So if you read it as though immediately after the 62, then what would you would have to have the cross right there at the end of the 62 weeks. But that's not what it's saying. It's not referring to that, the cross, it's referring to the time period. So after the 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off in that time period, but not for himself. And verse 27, and he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. 1 week. What 1 week is left to be talked about?
The
70th. The 70th week, right? So, you know, it can be very confusing when you're looking at these. You might want to, you have to follow me. You might want to, you know, give a 70-week time period and then add a 7 weeks and then add a 62 and then add another week. But that's not what that time period's talking about. So you start with the 70 and then you go back and fill in the 7 weeks and then the 62 weeks. And then the only one that's left when it talks about it is that 1 week.
Repetition and enlargement.
But yes, repetition and enlargement. Or repeat and enlarge. The repeat and enlarge.
Hebrews 2:1.
Yes. So he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, or make strong the covenant for many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease. What caused the sacrifice and oblation to cease?
It's fulfilled.
The cross, right? Fulfilled.
Amen.
So in the midst of the week, what happened?
Crucified.
The cross in the midst of the week. So that is our anchor point. It's very interesting that this time prophecy is given, and the central anchor point of this time prophecy is the cross. Do you know that as a people that stands on this time prophecy, you know what our central anchor point is to be?
Jesus.
The cross. Amen?
Amen.
God gave us a time period and he anchored it upon the cross. And we should take the example that he gave us. And we should be sure that we as a people that stand on this time period are going to be anchored upon the same thing, which is that cross. And for the sacrifice and oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. And again, I really wish I had a chart or a board that I could draw it out, because that's what I do, is I'll draw it out and then I'll look at the crowd and I'll see some blanks. And so I'll erase it and I'll do it again and I'll show it again. Because, you know, when I've been, how many evangelistic seminars has everyone here been through? Most of us have been through tons of them, right? But yet, we come to this time prophecy and go, huh? Don't we? Am I the only one? No, I know I'm not the only one. I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed, but I'm not totally, completely dull. So I know I'm not the only one. So, you know, the best way to get this time prophecy and to understand it is to teach it.
Amen.
Study it for the purpose and intent of teaching it. You know, the first time I presented this, I went through it, and I've got books littering all of my desk, and you know, I've got the Bible there, and I'm going from book to book, and I'm seeking to understand this, and I would come to a point where I'd say, okay, I've got to stop right here. Christy, let me teach this to you. And so, you know, I'd go find her wherever she was, and we'd sit down, and I'd go through that section, and I'd ask, does this make sense? Well, of course it makes sense, because she spent months studying the DNR and these time prophecies and is good with numbers. I'm not. But I just had to teach it. You know, I've just got to teach it. And as I taught it, it started to stick. And now I can do it without these PowerPoints. I can do it right from my Bible. And I've got, that's why, you know, I recommend a wide margin King James. You know, you look in this Bible, and you go, especially into the book of Revelation on my Bible, which now it's going to make a liar of me, but this Bible always opens to Revelation 14, and it's making a liar of me. But, you know, you look through here, and you can write a whole book based on the stuff that's in the margins. You know, we need to do that. We need to write these things down.
Wide margins. The Cambridge Bible.
The Cambridge.
And a couple of variations of the example.
Yeah.
But we generally use the Cambridge.
Yeah, the one I've got is the Thompson's Chain reference. This rest is extra. That's not Bible.
The Oxford.
The Oxford. Yeah, there's a few different wide margins, but you know, I recommend getting a wide margin. And sit down, study this, because there's going to come a time where we're going to be standing before a court. And we're going to have to give an answer. We're not going to be able to look at Pastor Allen and say, Pastor Allen, will you come up here and witness for me? We're not going to be able to look at anyone else and say, you know, will you come up here and do this? We are going to have to do it. We are going to have to give an answer to every man for the reason of our hope. That is found within.
Meekness and fear.
With meekness and fear.
But I think the Lord is going to speak through us. If it's in here, the Lord will bring it to our mind. We won't even have to take the Bible with us.
Correct. But we need to give the Spirit all the tools, because Christ said that the Holy Spirit will bring back to remembrance what?
All things over his top.
What's that? There was a bunch of different answers at once. The words...
Whatsoever things I have said unto you.
Yes. Whatsoever things I have said unto you. Which means that it has to be here already, doesn't it? It has to be put in. Now, we don't have to have it memorized. We should seek to memorize it. But if it's not memorized, it's okay. Let the Spirit work. Now, this was a very basic, and I'm sure a lot of you are going, you know that? Well, I could have done that in 10 minutes. But there's a purpose. You know, I want to try to simplify it for a lot of people that just don't understand it, that are maybe not the sharpest tool in the shed like me. And we need to be able to write this out. We need to be able to see it. And that's especially why I wanted to go through those sequence of events. Because it says that this time period of the 70 weeks was shiitakied off. Shiitakied off of what? The 2300. So when we add the 2300 back onto this event, the 70-week time period, do we add it on before? No, because that would bring us back to, what, 22-something? And that doesn't work. We need to know that this timeline is going to end after 1798. And how do we know that? Because of that sequence of events. Now, if we've got that sequence of events down, we can remember, once we work through this 70-week prophecy, then we know that we have to add the rest of it on to here, going this way. Does that make sense? And that brings us to what date? 1844. Too many numbers, right? The 1798 is a marker for us to remember that the Day of Atonement began after that 1798. See, if we get this, the 2300, and we put it to the wrong side of this prophecy, it doesn't bring us to after 1798.
The time of the end.
So we know that with that 1798 and that sequence of events, that the final conclusion is 1844. Now, why is it that we're going to have to answer for this? Why do you think? Or the biblical father and son? How many other religions out there have an understanding of the father and son as we do?
None.
There is no other organized religion that I'm aware of.
Few, I would say.
There are individuals. Believe it or not, there's a lot of individuals out there that have that understanding. They call it a trinity. But when you pin them down, they actually have a correct understanding. The 814, there's a couple other organized religions that we have this in common with. Of course, the corporate church, the corporate Adventist church, but also the COG, there's a segment of the Church of God that has this understanding as well.
Armstrong.
Yes, those that followed Armstrong, the old group. But for the most part, we're the only ones. And we're going to have to answer for it because it's different. Anything that we're different in, we're going to have to answer. Does that make sense?
Yeah. We get to.
We get to. Yes, good. I like the positive. We get to answer for it so that people get to hear. Do you have a comment?
A couple of other anchor points that helped me. One is when Jesus was being baptized, the King of the Universe, as King of the Universe, said, "This is my son." So you consider a son to be the prince to be the son of the king. So that helps establish it in people's minds. Also, in this prophecy, you've already covered Daniel 7:25 with the little horn who thought to change times and laws. So knowing that since he thought to do it, it was not legitimate to happen, but it was only a thought to do it or an attempt. Well, here it says that the covenant was confirmed with many for 1 week. It doesn't say he thought to confirm the covenant. If it said he thought to confirm the covenant, then it could be the Antichrist because they think to change. But God himself is the only one that can confirm
it. Very, very good point.
Yeah. Those very good. Extra little points all fit it all together very well.
Yes.
Brother, I hate to tell you, but you have to repeat everything you just said so people online can hear. So give a quick summation of what you just said.
A quick summation is the Antichrist in Daniel chapter 7, it says that he thinks to change times and laws. But here it says that he shall confirm, not think to confirm the covenant, but he will confirm the covenant. Now, the point that he was getting at is a lot of people try to apply this to the Antichrist power, and it doesn't fit. And so he was pointing out that the Antichrist can only think to confirm. But this verse did not say that he is trying to think to confirm. It says that he shall confirm, period, no question mark. It will happen. And the only one that can do that is God. So that confirmation is a positive thing referring to Christ, not the Antichrist. Do you have?
It could also be understood as testament, too.
Testament.
And it was the testament, says Paul, was confirmed with blood.
The testament was confirmed with blood, yes. And the blood was the cross. And so that anchor point, yet again, is that cross. And we need to always remember, for us, our anchor point should be the cross.
Some will ask you that if Christ was cut off in the midst of the week, how could he have confirmed the covenant for the full week? He did it personally for the 3.5 years. He did it through his disciples the second half. So that's the way to explain it.
So
personally, for 3.5 years, and through his disciples, the second 3.5, until Stephen was stoned, they were dispersed from the persecution.
Okay, so a quick repeat there is, how did he confirm it for the full week if he was cut off in the midst of the week? And the response was, he confirmed it personally for the first 3.5 years, or the first half week, and then he did it through his disciples for the last half of the week. Excellent. Our time is out. Thoughts or questions or comments? Well, shall we? How many can reproduce this Bible study now? The same show of hands. And unfortunately, you know, it makes it easier when you can see, when I draw it out. With that, then, I want to make a call first. How many of you see the importance of being able to reproduce an understanding of Daniel 8:14? How many of you want to continue searching so that you can reproduce it?
Amen.
Okay, let's take that decision to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the word, the sure word of prophecy that you have given to us. Father, we thank you that this word of prophecy has shined a light upon the anchor point, which is Christ and that cross. Father, I pray that each and every one of us will have that same anchor point, that our lives will be anchored upon Christ and upon that cross, that we may be able to show forth your Spirit to the world. Father, I pray that you will give each and every one of us an understanding of your word. And Lord, there are many here have raised their hands and said that they want to continue studying to be able to show themselves approved as workmen. Father, I pray that you will send your Spirit to lead and guide each and every one of us, that we may more fully understand your word. Father, I pray a special blessing again as we continue on in the week and we look at the final atonements. Father, I pray that you will fill us with your Spirit, that you will guide our minds to truths that will help us to further understand your truth, but more importantly, that these truths will help us to become more like Christ. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.